I'll let them all come in while I have some announcements. It's good to see everyone here this morning. Grateful that God has seen fit to draw us all together to worship Him as one body today. This week, we have a few things coming up that I want to make you aware of. The first is that this Wednesday, we will be having a family fun night for our kids. Last week, the kids decorated pillowcases. We were going to play a big game outside, and it started raining, so we played indoors. We had a s'more snack, heard a story about the Israelites. It was a lot of fun. So we would love to see kids come. We're going to have a different story this week. We're going to do some crafts. We'll play some games, and we'll have a delicious snack, because it wouldn't be a gathering of kids if we didn't have snack time, I don't think. So feel free to join us, even if you didn't sign up, and we will see you at 6 o'clock on Wednesday. And just another note about our schedule here at Bethany. Many of you are aware that Pastor John has been on sabbatical, and then he had COVID, and then he was on a mission trip, and then he finished his sabbatical. He is coming back next week, or this coming week. So he will be back in the office. You will see him up here preaching and leading prayers and those sorts of things. So he will be back early in the week, this coming week. So if you have any needs, you can call the office and talk to one of us here. But John will be around as well, just to make you aware. And also this morning, we have a guest with us. Not really a guest, though, Andy. Andy Hopp is going to be preaching here this morning. He attends here quite frequently, lives close by, and has been at the pulpit here at Bethany before. But be sure to welcome Andy as he shares God's word with us this morning. I think those are all of the announcements that I have for right now. There are other things in your bulletin. Be sure to pick one up on your way out if you didn't grab one on your way in. But let's just take a moment of silence, a pause, so that we can be present to this moment and what God is up to in our worship today. Gracious God, we are grateful that you have called us all together this morning. We are grateful for the ways that you work in our midst. Lord, be with us in a special way as we hear from your word, as we sing praises to you, as we pray, and as we gather as your people. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Would you stand as we worship together with song?
Drink of the water, come. that's a store that is made specifically for her. Like every 9-year-old girl, there's like something in Claire's for her. It's like a kid in a candy shop. And it kind of breaks my heart to think about it a little bit, but I was having a conversation with a friend of mine, and she said, like, you know, this, enjoy it now because, you know, there's going to be a time where she's not really interested in this stuff anymore, and they kind of outgrow it. And it made me think about kind of us on Earth. Like, there's a lot of things on Earth that we love. And at some point, when we pass away or when we mature spiritually, we're going to outgrow this life. And the next life, with Jesus, we're going to live forever, just like we just sang about. And so, no matter all the fruits, no matter all the good things, the fun things this world has to offer, it's the blood of Jesus that carries us on. And so that's what we're going to sing about right now.
Thank you. Thank you.
Heavenly Father, I just thank you so much that that your blood covers us. That no matter what happens in this life, you are there with us, walking with us, and leading us into eternal salvation with you. Lord, no matter how far we stray, you will do whatever it takes to find us, Lord. Lord, we praise your holy name. Lord, we thank you. We pray that as we gather here in your name, that you just open our hearts and our minds to receive you and your word today. We ask these things in your name. Okay, so we are joined together in worship. We are not joined with just ourselves. We have a bunch of people that are also joining us online. There's a little camera in the back, so let's make them feel welcome. Just turn on and wave to the camera. And then if you guys want to take a minute and greet each other, we will continue on with the service. Thank you.
So this summer, we've been challenged to engage in a new habit. If you remember, several weeks ago, we talked about ways to train ourselves to be godly, and one of the things that we talked about was adopting one of two habits. One was memorizing a scripture passage, and one was remembering gratitude every day and writing down things we were grateful for. So we have been memorizing 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 through 18 together. Some of us chose that as a challenge. Some chose the other one. So let's say these words together. Rejoice always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances. For this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 through 18. We tend to skip that last part, right? The reference, but it's really important to know where that came from. So if ever you need to find it, you can hunt it down. And I was thinking about memorization this week, that it is one of those things that you can do kind of mindlessly. I have memorized entire songs in languages that I do not understand, like Latin, or German, or Italian, or French. I could sing those words to you and not really know exactly what I'm saying. Like, I've read the gist of what the song says, but I don't know what every word means because I don't speak those languages. And at one point, my kids and I memorized part of Deuteronomy 6 in Hebrew. They might not even remember we did this, let alone the words. But they're just words if you memorize them and don't think about them at all. They don't really transform you in any way. The idea of memorization is to let those words sink really deeply in so that they become part of how we think about everyday life. So this week, if you took on the challenge of memorizing 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 through 18, share with someone else that verse and how it has shown up in your everyday life. You could call a friend, you could tell your spouse, you could talk to one of your kids. Tell them about that verse and how it is impacting your life in your everyday life. In the same way, we've been practicing gratitude and we've been recording things that we're grateful for every day. I am thinking that it's not real hard to think of things that we're thankful for on some days, and much harder on other days, or maybe in particular circumstances. So I would like us all to take just a second and consider something that you are grateful for already today. I mean, I know it's only a few hours in, but what is something that you're grateful for today, and then share that with someone who's sitting near you. I have to imagine a few people said air conditioning and fans. Right? Right. So we are going to lift those things that we're grateful for to God together right now. Would you pray with me? Gracious and generous God, we have just shared things with one another for which we are thankful. You give to us abounding blessings. We have been working to slow ourselves down in this season, to take time to listen to what you have for us to hear in one single verse from your word, and to notice the blessings that are all around us each and every day. Continue, God, to prompt us to see how you are at work, ways that we might not notice if we don't slow down. God, as we do this, we can be overwhelmed with gratitude to you, the giver of all good things. Thank you for all of the ways that you remind us of your faithfulness. God, we pray for your blessings of mercy and grace on those who are in need this morning. We lift to you the Cardarelli family and the recent passing of Joe's mom, Lucy. We lift also to you the Deckenich family in the recent loss of Jim and Sharon's son, Matt. Continue to provide your comfort for these families, Lord. Remind them of your nearness to them and continue to hold them in your loving arms. Lord, we also bring to you those who are in need of physical healing this morning. Continue to be with Vi as she steadily recovers from her back surgery. We thank you for the progress she's made thus far. Be with Kathy in her ongoing cancer treatments. We are thankful also that so far things are going so well. Provide healing for through Ron's surgery that's coming up to remove the tumor and anything else that's affected. We are grateful, God, that this is even an opportunity that he can have the surgery. We pray that you would work mightily in each of their bodies and of the bodies of others that we know who are suffering. We want them to return to health and strength, God, by your hand. Provide wisdom and clarity for doctors, nurses, and caregivers, that they would use their expertise and that you would use them to restore each one to good health. Generous God, we ask that you would provide for all that we need in the right timing. Help us to lean on you and to trust you in all that we encounter this week. Help us to continue to be those who rejoice always, who pray to you continually, and those who give thanks to you for the blessings that we see in all circumstances. We ask this in the strong name of Jesus, who taught his disciples to pray, saying, "Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. This morning, we continue to worship by offering to God what we have. There are many ways to give financially here at Bethany. Many of you have already done so as you came into church this morning. You can also mail your offering in or use the electronic options that are available. A lot of people really prefer that. So that information is on the screen. There are other ways that we give as well to the work that God has for us to do in this place. So I invite you to hold out your hands and imagine that within them you are holding what you give to God, whether that's a check you wrote or a note that you write to a friend, or if that is some way that you will give of your time or your talents. And imagine them, those things in your hands as we offer them to God. Gracious God, you have been abundantly generous with each of us. We are so grateful. With joyful hearts, we give back to you, offering these things to you that you might use them for your glory. Use them mightily, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Well, good morning. I didn't have anyone sitting by me, so I can share with all of you that what I am grateful for is to have this opportunity to share God's word with you this morning. It truly is a privilege and a joy for me. You know, the past 4 weeks, I have really enjoyed Pastor Jane leading us in a series of messages about the questions that Jesus asks, as recorded in the Gospels. That she has led us through a series of 4 messages about 4 of the 307 questions that Jesus poses, as recorded in the Gospels. And it got me to thinking about, if the Gospels record 307 some questions, this concept of questions that we ask and the answers to them has to be really important and really vital. And the more I thought about it over the course of the past several weeks, I realized that questions just drive every aspect of our lives. That it's not just here on Sunday morning that questions and answers make a difference. It's every aspect, whether it's at work or in our personal lives, or simple questions of what we're going to do, where we're going to go, what we're going to buy, how we're going to raise our children, what we're going to use as our moral authority, on and on. In fact, I was so moved by it this past week at work. I gave a big presentation at work about the importance of asking good questions to help us serve our clients better. I also started to think about, okay, in my life, what is the most important question that I ever ask someone? And I realized, I came to the conclusion that it has to be when I ask my wife, Lynn, will she marry me, right? Biggest impact on my life, and especially that's in my mind because we're just a few weeks away, Lynn and I, from celebrating our 30th wedding anniversary. But let me take you back to that night over 30 years ago when I asked her that most important question. I decided I was going to do it at dinner this night, and so we went to dinner at this nice restaurant. The problem was I didn't really think through all the details, right, of how I was going to do it. So we get to the restaurant, and we are seated there, and I decided, okay, I'm going to do this right away, right? I'm going to get this out of the way. I'm going to ask her right now. I reach in my pocket. Yeah, I got the ring all set, and I'm ready to ask her, got the courage worked up, and then here comes the waitress. Oh, would you like something to drink? Shoot, can't do it now, right? This is no good. I can't be interrupted in the middle of this. So, okay, well, I'll wait. And then I was getting ready to do it again, but then, okay, we placed our order. I said, okay, this is ridiculous. Here's what I'll do. I will wait until we're done eating, and then I'll ask, right? So we go through, we eat our food, and I finish eating, and I'm like, okay, I kind of push the plate ahead, muster up the courage again, reach in my pocket, yeah, I got the ring, and I lean forward, I'm ready to ask her, and I look up, and oh, she's still chewing. Can't ask her while she's chewing. You know, she eats much slower than I do. And I'm like, oh, shoot. And then they came and took away our plates, and oh, would you like some dessert? We ordered dessert, and I'm like, come on, Andy, you got to do this, man. Man up, do it, just do it. So we order dessert, and I'm like, okay, here it is. Now's the time. I reach in my pocket, I muster up the courage, I lean across the table, I grab her hand, I say something about how much I love her, and then I say, Lynn, will you marry me? She looks into my eyes, and she responds with this answer. I feel like I'm gonna be sick. Now, that was followed by tears, and I got to call my parents, and maybe a few minutes later I said, well, is that a yes or not? But obviously, it wasn't the answer I was looking for. It clearly wasn't the best answer at that moment. And I share that with you because today we're going to look at a passage of Scripture that not only tells us what is absolutely the most important question of them all. It is clearly, without a doubt, the most important question of them all, because this question, if you do not answer it correctly, it impacts every aspect of your life. It impacts where you will spend eternity. But the beauty of this is that in God's holy word, not only does he point out what is the most important question of them all, he gives us the answer. He gives us, in fact, the best answer to this question. And so today we're going to study what exactly is the best answer to the most important question of them all. I invite you to join me as we're going to open up God's word now to Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 20. And just to give you a little context here, this is well into Jesus' earthly ministry. It is an account of something that Jesus said and how the disciples responded. It is an account that also has parallel passages that record the same thing in Mark chapter 8 and Luke chapter 9. But we will read from Matthew's Gospel, Matthew chapter 16, starting at verse 13. Hear now God's holy word. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" And they replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he warned his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Christ. May God bless the reading and the hearing of his holy word. Please pray with me for just a moment. Almighty God, we come before your throne of grace and ask you send your Holy Spirit to be with us now. That your Holy Spirit open our minds and our hearts so that we don't just hear your word, but we allow you to work it within us to transform us and change us and convict us and encourage us so that we might know for certain how to answer the most important question of our lives, the question that will give us peace that passes all understanding. The question that will give us eternity in your presence. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O great God, our Savior and Lord, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we consider this morning this best answer, I want us to see that there are actually four elements to what is the best answer to the question of who is Jesus. These four elements are as follows: that we have to first recognize the work of Jesus. We recognize what Jesus does. Secondly, we have to realize the person of Jesus, who Jesus really is. We then have to understand fully that the revelation of who Jesus is and what he does comes from God himself. And finally then, it is good that we notice and see that the results are the affirmation that we are giving the real answer. Okay? We need to recognize the work of Jesus. We need to realize the person of Jesus. We need to understand the revelation of where this comes from, where knowledge of Jesus comes from. And finally, we need to be able to see the results to affirm that we truly believe what we are saying. We start by recognizing the work of Jesus. The text says, as Peter answers this question, that who is Jesus? He starts with, and critically does, you are the Christ. The first and most critical element of this is to understand that Jesus is in fact the Christ, the Messiah, the promised one. Christ is the Greek for the Hebrew Messiah, which means anointed one. The one that the scriptures point to, the one that God has promised to come and be the Savior of the world. Now, I think here, this is one of the times when we have to realize that, you know, for Peter, this was a big jump. Because they had a different understanding of who the Messiah would be, who the Christ would be, and what he would accomplish. We have the benefit, in some ways, we have the benefit because we know the rest of the story, right? We know that he goes to the cross. We know that he dies on the cross, that he rises again, all of that. But at this point, Peter didn't know that yet. The disciples weren't fully aware of that yet. We have the benefit of seeing the whole big picture, and we have to realize that the work of Jesus, what he does, is to be our substitutory atonement, like we just saying a few minutes ago, right? His blood washes us clean. He is our substitute, paying the price for our sins. This is the work of the Messiah, what he does. For us, we have to fully and completely acknowledge that Jesus, in fact, pays the price for our sins. But here is where it becomes difficult. Because we have to confess, we have to believe that truly Jesus is the Lamb of God who comes to take away the sin of the world. But you know what that means? We have to admit that we are actually sinners. And guess what? Newsflash, we live in a world where people don't like to know they're sinners, right? Imagine if every Sunday you came and we just talked about being sinners, right? How would you like that? Nobody wants to hear that. Nobody likes to be held accountable. It just goes against our human nature, right? To be able to admit that we are sinners, that truly we have to realize the best of our righteous acts are but filthy rags. And I find it interesting that nobody wants to talk about this. In fact, I noticed, you know, and this is no criticism, just an observation, did we do a prayer of confession this morning? No, we don't do that. I remember at the church I used to serve at, we used to always do this, right? But I'll tell you, it was very brief, right? We say, okay, now we're going to do a prayer of confession, time of silent prayer. Nobody wants to hear this out loud, all of my sins, right? And it was like 5 seconds you would allow the congregation to offer their prayer of confession, right? And then we would go on. Well, we had a visiting pastor from Pennsylvania one time. His name was Matt. Matt, you want to lead us through some of the service here? You do the prayer of confession. And so he introduces the prayer of confession. He says, we're going to do a silent prayer of confession. Let us confess our sins to God. Boom. 5 seconds go by. 15 seconds go by. A minute goes by. 2 minutes go by. He like held us in that prayer of confession for like 5 minutes, right? And after the service, I said to Matt, I'm like, hey, Matt, I got to tell you, I don't know, that's not how we normally do that here. He's like, what, you guys in Wisconsin don't sin? In Pennsylvania, we would have just been getting started. You know, the reality is that everybody truly does know they are sinners, but doesn't want to acknowledge it, doesn't want to admit it. I learned this years ago at a vacation Bible school, the reality of, really, we do know we are sinners. It was at a vacation Bible school, and we were just starting the vacation Bible school, and I had the responsibility of doing kind of the opening session, and we combined with other churches, so we had this whole gym full of adults and children for the opening session of vacation Bible school, and I knew, okay, we're teaching about Jesus all week, but the first thing we have to do is understand that everybody here has to realize we actually need a Savior because we are sinners in need of a Savior, right? So how am I going to get all these adults and all these kids to understand that? And I said, okay, here we go. Here's what I'm going to do. And I was going to do this morning, but I'll just tell you about it. I asked everyone, please stand. And everybody stood, and I said, okay, here's the deal. I'm going to ask you a question, and you'll have to sit down if you say yes to it, right? And I said, okay, everyone here, if any of you have broken any of the Ten Commandments today, I'm going to ask you to sit down, right? And I thought, well, this will be great. A couple of the parents will sit down, but all the kids will stand up, and I'll work them up to, you have to honor your father and mother, and that'll get them, right? Well, that's what I thought would happen. You know what happened? I said, okay, anyone here, you have to sit down if you broke any of God's Ten Commandments. Whoosh! Down they went. Oh, I guess you do know you are sinners in need of a Savior. The Scriptures teach us, if you confess your sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. That is the work of Christ. The first element of the best answer is to be able to say, Jesus is the Christ, the one who has paid the price for our sins. The second element is to realize that Jesus is, in fact, the person of Jesus, which is to say this, Peter says, the Son of the living God. Jesus is truly God, and the mystery of Jesus being fully divine and fully human is so important to our confession, to our answer, to the best answer. And Jesus kind of walks through here in a very interesting way, because he starts by asking his disciples, he says, who do they say that I am? Who do the people say that I am? And they respond by what? Saying first, well, some say you're John the Baptist. And we often just go through these and say, well, that was a really bad answer. But really, it wasn't that bad an answer when you think about it. Why would they think he was John the Baptist? Because what was John the Baptist's message? He was preaching a baptism of repentance, right? That they had to repent and have their sins forgiven. What did Jesus preach? The Gospels tell us in Matthew 4, verse 17. From that time on, Jesus began to preach, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So it's not that bad an answer, is it? What John the Baptist was preaching, Jesus was also preaching. Okay, not a bad answer, not the right answer or the best answer. And they said, well, some people think you're Elijah. Well, what about that one? Well, let's see, Elijah was this prophet that did all of these amazing miracles, right? The widow's son he brought back to life, called on fire from heaven. What was Jesus doing? Jesus was doing very much the same kinds of things, amazing miracles. In fact, Jairus' daughter he brought back to life. All of these feeding of the thousands and other miracles. And they're like, okay, yeah. And besides that, they knew their Bible. They knew their Bible, right? In Malachi it says that Elijah would come and return before the great and dreadful day of the Lord. Oh, maybe he's Elijah. That's a possible answer. Not the right answer, not the best answer. Or maybe he's Jeremiah, and one of the prophets, they say. Now, why would they say that? And actually, that's not a bad answer either, because Jeremiah was someone who spoke God's word, but he was what? The crying prophet, right? He was someone who had great compassion for the people. This is actually shows us the character of Christ, that he was full of compassion and care, like Jeremiah. Spoke God's word like the other prophets. So again, not a bad answer, but not the right answer, not the best answer. And on top of this, I think it's important, we're given more information here, because we are given the location of where Jesus is. He's in Caesarea Philippi, right? And here's the backstory on Caesarea Philippi, why this is key, this is important. You see, Caesarea Philippi wasn't always named that. At first it was named Peneus, because in that city there was a cave with a river coming out of it that was a place that became a temple of worship for the false god Pan. And then when Herod took control, he built an ivory temple there to Caesar, so now they could worship Caesar there, and renamed this the city Caesarea Philippi in honor of Caesar. It was a place of all kinds of idol worship. So here is Jesus asking this question of them in a place where they're surrounding with all kinds of false gods, where people thought there was many gods out there, all of these things. And Jesus says, who do you say that I am? I think today we can actually make a very similar parallel in our world, can't we? To living in a world, in a place, being in a place where many people will not acknowledge that Jesus is God, where there are all kinds of other gods that people love to put out there, right? We, in effect, are living in our own Caesarea Philippi. There was a study done by Ligonier Ministries back in 2020, and it revealed that 52% of Americans do not believe that Jesus is God. A more recent survey done in 2022, 37% of Gen X, 38% of people 18 to 25, 35% of baby boomers, etc. We live in a world that does not want to believe that Jesus is God. What about the Muslims? What do they believe? They say, oh, Jesus, he's a great prophet, right? Great prophet, a teacher, absolutely, but he is not God. Jews today, what do they say? Oh, well, Jesus was a great rabbi, a great teacher, but he was not God. Our world is a place where everyone loves to say, oh, Jesus, yeah, he was a historical figure. Oh, yeah, Jesus was a great teacher. Oh, an amazing leader. Really, oh, his moral compass was just amazing. He was an incredible man. But the world says he was not God. But we must say, Jesus is God, because the scriptures make it very, very clear. John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. John 10:30, Jesus says, I and the Father are one. Paul writes to the church in Colossus, he writes this, Colossians 1:16-17, describing Jesus, for by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Jesus raised the dead. He healed the sick. He fed the thousands. He controlled the wind and the rain. He was born of a virgin. All of those things show us. In fact, Jesus declared, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. We have to affirm. We have to know. We have to say, Jesus is God. You see, because the person of who Jesus is and the work of Jesus are atoning sacrifice. They are locked together. You can't have one without the other. You can't have a sacrifice that washes us whiter than snow if Jesus is not God, because no human would be sinless and be that sacrifice. These two go together. We can't miss it. The second key element Jesus is God. What is the application here? Let me go in a little different direction for a moment, because my fear is that right now, in the back of some of your minds, if you were totally honest, if we had an open dialogue, and you could be truly honest, you'd say to me, "But Pastor Andy, you know, sometimes I have questions. Sometimes I wonder. Sometimes I even maybe doubt a little bit." And to that, I would say, that's okay. In fact, good. Now we're getting somewhere. Because now you're being real. You're being authentic. And the reality is, we are all sinners who struggle with these questions of faith. That in reality, we all have questions. That at times we can all have doubts. Which is why the next element is so important. Because we have to understand that who Jesus is, what he has done, is revealed to us by the Father. The revelation comes from God. Jesus says to Peter, "For this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven." We have to remember that we are in fact dead in our trespasses and sin. We're not just a little sick. We don't just need a little shot. No, we are totally dead. That the only way to come to know who Jesus is and what he does for us is because God has sent his Holy Spirit to open our hearts, to give us that opportunity to learn. It is by grace through faith we are saved. It is God's grace. It is his mercy. It is not what we do. "Oh, I got smarter, so now I can know about Jesus." No, it's because of the grace of God. And yes, there is a part in there where we have to accept Jesus. We have to seek him, absolutely. But let us never forget that the true revelation comes from the Father in heaven, opening our minds, softening our hardened hearts. And so when we struggle, when we have questions, where do we turn? We turn to the one who gives us faith. Our God is big enough to take our challenges and our questions. The author of Hebrews said, what are we to do? We are to keep our eyes upon Jesus, fix our eyes upon Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. It's a work in progress. But it's God who produces the increase. The Apostle Paul would say this in 1 Corinthians 3, verse 8. He's talking about going around and planting the seed of the gospel as he started all these churches. Paul says, "I planted." I'm the one who put the seed there. And then he said, another man came around, Apollos. Apollos came and he watered that seed a little bit. But who? It is God who gives the increase. The revelation of who Jesus is, we have to always recognize, always know, and realize the revelation comes from the Father in heaven. So when we struggle, that's where we need to go. The Christian journey, the Christian walk is so much the most excellent way. But it's not an easy way. And the Church of Jesus Christ today, Bethany Church here, I would challenge you, are you a place where God's people can come and ask those questions? If you want your youth to really grow up in the faith, you have to be a church that says, "Hey, come here and ask your questions. Bring us your doubts. We'll walk with you through those. Together we'll turn to God." My son was growing up, and we sent him to a very popular youth group. And finally he said to us, "Mom and Dad, I'm never going there again." We said, "Why not? If I ask a question, they chew me up. They spit me out." That was it. We cannot be an obstacle to people. The church needs to be a place where people can come with their questions, go to God and say, "Lord, fill us with your grace. Since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has granted us access into this grace in which we now stand." We stand together in God's grace. And it is by grace alone we are saved. You know, as we then consider the fact that really it is not enough to simply memorize the words, right? Pastor Jane was kind of getting at that with the memory verse today. It is not enough just to memorize these words. You have to live them. You have to let them sink in. You have to let them change your lives. Here's what the scripture says. Paul writes in Romans 10 that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. It is more than just knowing the words to speak. We have to have them in our hearts. We have to truly have faith. We have to truly believe them. And then we can answer the ultimate question. And the way that we know we have it right is because we'll see the results, because that produces a transformation. It produces new life in Christ. It is how you are born again, as the Holy Spirit fills you and you start to see, hey, I look at things differently now. I do things differently now. But the struggle here is, and this is so hard for some people, is they have no assurance because they're like, well, I'm really not very good yet. I said, Jesus is my Savior and Lord yesterday, but I woke up on Monday morning and, you know, I wasn't perfect. That's okay. We're works in progress, people. And if you don't think that's the case, just keep reading in Matthew's account what happens next. Here is Peter. Peter, who makes this incredible confession. And Jesus says, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, right? You know what happens? Keep reading. In two verses, he goes, get behind me, Satan. He wasn't perfect right away. In fact, you keep reading, you'll see he denied Jesus three times. We are works in progress, but you will start to see, you will notice that something is different in you as you are filled with the Holy Spirit, as you become more Christ-like. All of us must know and see in our hearts and in our lives, by the way we live, something is different. Because I truly know who Jesus is and what he has done. Let me conclude with this. The bottom line is this. I give you a little example. In 1563, a German king by the name of Frederick III decided he needed a tool, a better way to teach his people about Jesus. He said, especially for the young people, I need a tool that I can use to teach people about Jesus. And he commissioned a bunch of theologians, and he gave control of this effort to two men, Caspar Olivianus and Zachary Yersinius. And he said, I want you to make me a tool for teaching the Christian faith. And you know what they did? They put together a tool that was 129 questions and answers. Some of you know of this because it has been in the Reformed Church tradition ever since. It is the Heidelberg Catechism. When I was in high school, I had to go to catechism class, right? For 2 years, I had to learn and memorize the questions and the answers of the Heidelberg Catechism. And after a year and a half, I had it to hear. I'm like, you gotta be kidding me. These questions, these answers, memorize all of this stuff. Oh, I did half of what I'm memorizing. I don't even know, and I just couldn't anymore. So I went to my dad. I said, Dad, I just can't do this catechism class thing anymore. Do I really have to remember all of those questions and answers? And my father, in his wisdom and as the greatest spiritual mentor anyone could ever have, he thought for a minute, and he said to me, Andy, here's the deal. I'll tell you what. You don't have to memorize all of those questions and answers. I ask only one thing. You memorize and understand just the first question and answer. Because if you get that one, you know what is truly important. And so I learned what is my only comfort in life and in death is that I belong both body and soul in this world and the next to my faithful Savior Jesus Christ, who has fully and completely satisfied for all of my sins. And when I got that right, when I understood what it means to belong to Jesus, everything changed. And so I can say, who is Jesus? He is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just give you praise and thanks that you are a God who not only asks the questions, but gives us the answers. Father, we pray today that if any here are struggling, if any here are uncertain, that you are truly the Christ, that you are truly God. We pray that the Father send more Spirit, more grace upon us all to grow us and in our faith, to know for certain who Jesus is. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's go ahead and stand as we continue to worship together.
He rose and conquered.
To him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the one God our Savior, be all glory, honor, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, who was before all time, is now, and will be forevermore. Amen.
Praise God.